Family mode.
Welcome everyone to the Drug-Free Action Alliance program webinar series. Today's session will feature the Rocky Mountain HIDA report. I am Derek Longmire and will serve as today's moderator. And with me today is Tony Coder, Assistant Director and Communications Manager, also with Drug-Free Action Alliance. And Tony was also just recently named to the Board of Directors of SAM, Smart Approaches to, or Small Alternatives to Marijuana. Due to the quantity of callers, all attendees will be muted throughout the webinar. However, we do want your feedback, so if you have questions, please enter them into the questions field of the GoToWebinar navigation panel. Technical assistance questions will be answered in the order in which they are received, and program-specific questions will be queued until the question and answer portion of the session. Should you have technical difficulties during today's webinar, please contact the GoToWebinar helpline at 800-263-6317. They will need to know the webinar ID to assist you, which is 232-630-944. Again, the helpline number is 800-263-6317, and your webinar ID is 232-630-944. For those of you unfamiliar with Drug-Free Action Alliance, we are a nonprofit organization with specialization in program development focused on strengthening community coalitions and enhancing environmental prevention. Drug-Free Action Alliance is based in Columbus, Ohio, with programming implemented in all 50 states as well as U.S. territories and other countries. For those in your community who are unable to attend today's webinar, a recording of the session will be available at drugfreeactionalliance.org, and that will be posted within the next week, as well as slides from today's session. And when those are available, I will email them out to all attendees as well, so you can have that to pass on to your community partners. With that, we'll turn things over to Tony Coder to take it from there.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us today. Good morning if you're on the West Coast. So we're happy to have you here today, and thank you so much. I know this is a hot topic right now. Marijuana legalization right now, there are 20 states that have marijuana legalization policies, whether for medicinal purposes or for recreational purposes, with Colorado and Washington legalizing it last November for recreational purposes. One of the things that my background is in policy. I was a lobbyist for the Ohio Department of Job and Family Services and their legislative director for a number of years, and I've been doing kind of government work for 12 or 13 years. So I'm not really a preventionist per se. I'm on my way to getting my prevention certification, but my primary focus with everything we do at Drug-Free Action Alliance is through the policy piece. And one of the things that that really kind of astounds me is some of the messages that prevention folks have kind of taken throughout the years. Back in the 1930s, here's your marijuana messages, which we still get, you know, with the reefer madness piece is what still gets thrown at us nowadays. And as you can see, you know, a lot of the reefer madness, women cry for it, men die for it. Drug-crazed abandon. You've got a good girl until she lights a reefer, and then you've got the devil kind of getting the young lady there and a vicious racket with its arms around your children. Those types of kind of scare tactics have really kind, to me, have put a bad image to what preventionists do. But then we swung the other way as well. Those were in the 1930s. This is 2014. Just pulled them right off the internet. But these are some of the ads that we've seen, and it's kind of swung 180 degrees. The marijuana messages where you're with the devil in the 1930s. Now marijuana is safer than water, which is one of the claims of a pro-marijuana group. God made weed, man made beer, in God we trust, which kind of coincides with a lot of the marijuana is safer than alcohol media campaign that pro-pot lobbyists have right now. And then they even go as far as marijuana doesn't affect driving performance. Toke of the Town is a website that is dedicated to the pro-pot lobby. So if you look at the way that messages have come, I think we've kind of shot ourselves in the foot around marijuana. We've used all of these scare tactics. It's going to cause all of these awful things, and you know, everything from the devil getting you to you're going to be a good girl gone bad type thing, to now where it's absolutely the messages are that it's a benign plant, that it doesn't cause any kind of repercussions or consequences. And again, it's safer than water. So which message is real? Is it harmless? Is it like Jaws down in the left-hand side, where it's harmless, or where it's harmful and Jaws, you know, marijuana Jaws is going to come and get you out of the water? Or is it the Debbie Boone light up your life pot leaf that you know, just light up, big deal, mellow out, that kind of stuff? So I really like to pay attention more to what the numbers are, which is why I think the Colorado HIDA report is so important. What is HIDA? HIDA is the high-intensity drug trafficking area. It's an arm of the Office of National Drug Control Policy, which is an office within the White House that is responsible to for reducing drug trafficking and production in the United States. There are 28 regional HIDAs across the United States, with funding for 681 initiatives. Not everybody is in a HIDA district. In fact, only 16% of all counties in the United States are HIDA counties, but they seem to be the higher population counties, with about 60% of the entire population living within a regional HIDA. The Colorado HIDA report, again, I like this because it just takes simple numbers. You know, what is happening to Colorado especially? And I know that there are some folks from Colorado who have signed up for this. You could probably talk a lot better anecdotally than I ever can. You guys are living it. But basically what the Rocky Mountain HIDA report did is it says that that Colorado serves as an experimental lab, and these words were kind of echoed by President Obama a few weeks ago when he called in the New Yorker. He called Colorado and Washington experiments. So this is kind of a social experiment to see the impacts of legalization, especially the numbers that we're going to look at today. They're going to be numbers from when Colorado first became a medicinal marijuana state. But what the Rocky Mountain HIDA report wanted to do, they wanted to look at the validity of pro-pot claims. If you ever listen to the marketing pieces for pro-marijuana, it's always we want to eliminate arrests. So many people are in prison for simple marijuana possession. If we did that, then we could free up law enforcement to do some other things, reduce traffic fatalities. If people smoked marijuana instead of alcohol, there'd be a lot safer roads. There's no increase in use. A lot of claims are that teens will actually leave marijuana alone. If you just legalize it, there won't be the stigma with it, or the bad. The danger with it if it's legalized. Also, of course, you know, states want the added revenue, and let's get rid of the cartels. If we just legalize pot, the cartels will go away. They'll go work at Subway as sandwich artists or whatever. So they created this report, and what they did was they used three different eras in Colorado's legalization history. They went 2006. Colorado legalized marijuana for medicinal purposes back in 2000. Well, they wanted to take the early part of the medical marijuana era when things were actually starting to go, which is 2006 to 2008. In 2009, actually in late 2008, a judge ruled that during a person, a caregiver, which is someone who takes care of medical marijuana patients who have, who can have 12 plants per patient, I think, for 5 patients, that and there were no dispensaries allowed up until 2008. So those were the early medical marijuana pieces that were just beginning. In 2009, when dispensaries were open, things really seemed to change around the medical marijuana industry. And that's really when medical marijuana expanded. And now, there's also the 2012 to right now. Well, actually, this was produced in August of 2013. So it's somewhere around May were their last statistics. The medical marijuana expansion and the recreational use era. So they're also starting to take that into account. From what I understand from talking to folks who helped create this, that they will have another report in a few years that will be a that will be an update to what they're what they have now. As you see, 2008, what happened in Colorado? There were about 4,800 cardholders. There were not retail stores. The regulation of 5 patients per caregiver, and only about 55% of people designated a caregiver. Well, the judge made that ruling, and at the end of 2009, there were 41,000 cardholders. Something must have happened in Colorado. I'm guessing the plague happened, that 35,000 people actually or 36,000 people actually became sick for that to happen. And now at the end of 2012, there were 532 licensed dispensaries in Colorado and 108,000 patients, which are people who have a medical marijuana card. But you look at that a little bit closer, and the cardholders mostly are for severe pain. Pain, as I often say in a lot of my trainings that I do, it's very, very difficult to diagnose. If I tell you I have pain, it's kind of hard to measure. There are pain management specialists that actually specialize in those types of things. But it really is difficult to understand if someone really has pain. And actually in Denver, we go back to the after this judge's ruling, there are more dispensaries than pharmacies or liquor stores in the city of Denver. So things really started to take off, and as I call it, the green rush. Used to be the gold rush back in the 1900s, the 1800s and 19th century. And so now we've got the green rush. The subjects covered in the Haida report, which is on our website, it's a free report. It was something that was released across the United States. I don't think it got a whole lot of airplay, a whole lot of attention, but some of the subjects covered, they broke it down into 6 different areas that we'll cover today, and I'm going to cover these really, really quickly. This is a taste of, but I really, really want to drive people to the report. I usually do like a 6-hour training on this. I also do have some pieces on policy work, what is really going on within the policy. But this report is broken down into 6 different areas. Driving fatalities, Colorado youth marijuana use, Colorado adult marijuana use, Colorado ER admissions due to marijuana, diversion of Colorado marijuana, just generally, and also through the U.S. Postal Service is number 6. Section 1, you look at car crashes, you look at fatalities. The Federal Highway Administration estimates the crash costs due to medical and lost productivity is about $99 billion, according to the CDC and the Federal Highway Administration, which basically equates for about $500 for every licensed driver, whether you're in an accident or not. So it's a troubling issue that affects our insurance agents, that affects our insurance costs across the nation. And they wanted to look at what is, does marijuana actually add to car crashes and car fatalities? Some other pieces, NIDA, which is the National Institute of on Drug Abuse, says after alcohol, THC is the most active ingredient in marijuana found in the blood of impaired drivers, fatally injured drivers, and motor vehicle crash victims. So after alcohol, marijuana is pretty highly detected in those types of cases. The British Medical Journal, as well as the epidemiological reviews in 2012 of 9 studies, cited that marijuana use doubles the risk of car crashes, and this was done peer-reviewed and studied over and over. Again, the epidemiological review of these studies basically concluded that you're 2 times as likely to be in a crash if you have smoked marijuana. So the other troubling stat for me is that Liberty Mutual Insurance Group teamed up with Students Against Destructive Decisions, which is kind of the young person Mothers Against Drunk Driving survey. And the survey basically found that 19% admitted to driving after smoking marijuana, and these are teenagers who were driving, so 16 to 19, with 36% stating that marijuana smoking did not distract while you were driving. And what's scary to me is that 34% who admitted to smoking or driving, that's wrong there, who admitted to driving while high said it made them a better driver. That's really, really astounding to me. But it kind of goes back to one of the slides or one of the pro-marijuana messages that it doesn't really hurt driving from the talk of the town in I think the third slide that I have. So there really is a misunderstanding, especially with young people, that marijuana doesn't make them a better driver. It actually increases your chances for traffic crashes, traffic fatalities. And this these statistics are also in the report. In Colorado, and this is from the Colorado Department of Public Health and the Environment, from the Rocky Mountain Hydra report, as you can see, in 2009, you had about 791 THC positives. That number almost doubled to 1,489, and then you add another 600 or so of up over 2,030 of drivers that tested positive for THC, which is a huge increase. You're talking almost what a 200-300% increase over those 2 years. And again, it goes kind of back to when dispensaries were opened up and when it became more of a commercialized product instead of just mom and pop growing it in their backyard or basement or whatever they were doing. The Colorado Hydra report also looked at fatalities. In 2006 to 2011, overall in Colorado, traffic fatalities decreased by 16%. So that is across the board. And that seemed to be a trend up until last year, actually, that traffic fatalities have were decreasing. However, if you look at traffic fatalities involving drivers testing positive for marijuana, that more than doubled. It increased 114%. And this graph is actually a graph from the Rocky Mountain Hydra report that you can actually see the numbers of fatalities by a driver with positive THC in their system. So really, that's another issue. That I kind of question their theory that marijuana is safer than water when you're having this kind of increase with traffic fatalities. Also, in 2006, 28% of all fatal vehicle crashes involving drugs, the person had pot in their system. That number increased in 2011. It doubled to 56%. Of fatal vehicle crashes involving drugs. So huge increase in marijuana drug-induced driving and those types of things. according to the Rocky Mountain HIDTA report. Another big problem that is being looked at is marijuana and youth. For the first time, this happened in 2009, more young Americans started smoking marijuana than cigarettes, a totally legal product. And this was a CDC stat as well that it's actually kind of beats by 5%. And as you look, it's not only the marijuana use that is going up, but it's also, which is in the blue on your screen, but there's also the red, which the perceived risk of harm. And you're talking about that young people are starting to see occasional marijuana use is no big deal. That it's benign, it's safe, it won't hurt me, it's a lot safer than alcohol and all of those other things. So you can see that young people are buying that, you know, this is not that bad. And these are some of the quotes that we have heard from young people. It's harmless, it's natural, it's not addictive, it doesn't hurt me, it makes me feel calm, it doesn't affect my grades, it's safe because it's medicine, all of these other things. And these are things that young people think. But you look at, and this is one of the things that Attorney General of the United States said that there should be no increase in youth use. However, if you look at the graph that was released by SAMHSA and the National Conference of State Legislatures, all of the states in red are medical marijuana states. And this is past month marijuana users age 12 to 17. Only New York and North Carolina kind of made it into the top 20, top 22. But the majority of states with their more lax marijuana laws, where marijuana is legal for medicinal or recreational purposes, you can see that also their teen use goes up. So that is another concern that we have across the nation. Recent studies have shown that marijuana is addictive, that if you're an adult and you smoke marijuana, you have a 1 in 11 chance of getting addicted. But that number drops to 1 in 6 if you're under the age of 15. A New Zealand study, which has been peer-reviewed twice, actually showed what they did is they measured people, New Zealand back in, I think, 1970, just followed people throughout their lives. And what they found after, I think, 38 years of study was that people who smoked marijuana throughout their lifetime, especially when they started young, and again goes back to youth smoking of marijuana, actually had an 8-point IQ loss. You think, what's big deal, 8 points, which is no big deal. If you're a Mensa member, if you're 140 IQ and you drop 8 points, you're still pretty darn smart. You're still going to be doing good in school. You'll probably still be a success in life. However, the average IQ is 100 points, and you drop from 100 to 92, you start approaching what's called the dull category, which you might not make into college. You might be jeopardizing some of your dreams that you may have in life. And also, studies are starting to come out, and they're stronger and stronger in their findings, is that the link between marijuana use during adolescence and the increase in the risk of schizophrenia and psychosis. In fact, a study was just done. I have the Netherlands study, but a study was literally just done on the Feinberg School of Medicine at Northwestern University. That the study director said this is one of the first studies to demonstrate a direct link between marijuana-related brain abnormalities and cognitive functions. And even the Dan Lin, who's the executive director of the Illinois National Organization to Reform Marijuana Laws, or NORML, which some of you, it's a pro-pot lobbying group, I mean, he even mentioned the story that there's always been a link between cannabis and schizophrenia. He acknowledges that. And as we take up this debate, especially recently, all of the issues, there's a debate about mental health and what we can do about that. The last thing I think we really need to be adding on top of that is something that has a strong tie to mental health, to mental illness, psychosis, and those types of things. So I think we also need to take that into account, especially for our young people. And again, a Mount Sinai study, they reviewed 120 studies of youth marijuana use, and they said that marijuana is a safe drug, is scientifically inaccurate. There needs to be more research about brain development. There's an association between cannabis use and subsequent addiction to heavy drugs, psychosis, and other genetic behaviors that factor into later drug use. So there seems to be more and more science. The National Institute of Drug Abuse also has a great deal of science behind youth marijuana use and what is and what current findings are. The Colorado, the Rocky Mountain HIDA report, when they use their stats, they use 30-day data. That's classified as current use. So basically, if the young person has used marijuana in the last 30 days, that is considered current. They focused on grades 9 through 12 primarily. However, they did also factor in some middle schools. And most data was collected from 2006 to 2011. As you see, the national average of current marijuana use ages 12 to 17 is about 7.6%. You see a huge jump in the average current use of Colorado youth. It's over 10% at this point. And Dr. Christian Thurstone, who is a fellow board member on the SAM Smart Approaches to Marijuana board that I serve on, says if Denver Public High Schools were considered a state, that state would have the highest past month marijuana use rate in the United States, right behind New Hampshire. So there seems to be a trend going on with just the numbers of young people who are using marijuana in the Rocky Mountain State, what actually happens to be, in my opinion, one of the most beautiful states in the nation. My father and I used to go to Estes Park all the time when I was younger, and just one of my favorite states in the world. So it really saddens me to see the young people using this and kind of get fooled by the press. As you see, Adams County High School, their current use rate, it was about 20%. They had a problem in 2008 to 2010. However, there was a 39% increase. Again, you get past that 2009 when the dispensary started coming in. It created a 39% increase to almost 30% of young people who currently use marijuana. Again, it goes back to if they've used within the last 30 days. Adams County Middle School also had a 50% increase. These are young people who are 6th, 7th, and 8th grade who, about 5%, now it's at 8.5%. Again, all of this is in the Rocky Mountain HIDA report. And what is also troubling is Colorado Springs High School, where students testing positive for marijuana 2007 to 2009, which was before the big dispensary started hitting the commercialization. I don't want to call this legalization anymore. Let's just call it what it is. It's commercialization. About 5 students on average were tested positive for marijuana. That grew to 17.3 students on average. That really is a big increase, along with the amount of THC that's in the young person's system was from 225 to 396. And this, to me, is the most troubling. Is we put so much on our teachers, we put so much on our school systems. Yet this does not do any kind of school system or any kind of community where you're trying to raise safe people and trying to get them to go to fulfill their potential in life, whether it's college, whether it's trade school, whether it's some kind of career and whatever it is, this really limits their potential, especially if they can't go to school. Again, you go back, there were about 3,700 drug-related expulsions in Colorado in 2008-2009. In 1 year, that jumped to 4,956. So you had a 1,200 child increase in 1 year of expulsions, and then that number rose to 5,417, and then came back down a little bit to 5,279 kids. That is really robbing a person of their future. If you don't get an education, it really, really limits on what you're going to do in life. The success that every parent wants their child to have. So again, these are simple numbers. There's no scare tactics or anything involved. It's just simply looking at numbers across the Rocky Mountain State. Colorado adult marijuana use. This is what I usually get when I do trainings. I usually get this look. Latina Fey has on her face. Who cares? What do I care if somebody wants to smoke a little doobie or a little blunt in their in the privacy of their own home? Again, you know, if marijuana were legalized, we wouldn't have senseless arrests. Why do I care if someone smokes a little pot? If we just regulated tax it, be more money for the state. All of these types of things. Well, the perception, you know, that people are arrested for having a joint in their pocket really is kind of a fallacy. If you look at state inmates, also even federal prisoners, you really have all of them less than 1% for spending any time in jail, being a prisoner for marijuana possession. There are people in for marijuana trafficking. But really, when you look at the total picture, that's kind of a fallacy that's been just kind of propagated throughout our society. I understand that the ACLU and some of those folks, the Marijuana Policy Project, which is another pro-pot organization, have said that there are like 700,000 arrests. Again, people are not going to jail for having a joint in the pocket. However, if you look at alcohol, which is a totally legal drug, that is responsible for 2.6 million arrests across the nation, which is a million more than for all illicit drugs combined. So if you're legalizing it, will it mean less arrests? Actually, alcohol has shown that no, it doesn't. It actually leads to more, which then leads to more police needs and prisons and all of those other things. So why do I care if someone smokes a little pot? Because it affects everybody. Most of the talks, the presentations that I do are to business folk who it affects their bottom line. It's workplace safety issues, children's services agencies, which you talk about parent readiness, safety of the child, foster care systems, colleges, education. I don't know how you're a teacher in this day and age, especially where there's legal marijuana, when your job is dependent upon testing requirements. And then just law enforcement, keeping the road straight, keeping our community safe. And then also, I always say legislators, because of budget and jobs, and then there's election time issues, which is always when they go back to the kids, we love the children type thing. So what does pot mean for business? And I got this from one of our partners here in Ohio, Working Partners, who are a third-party administrator for Drug-Free Workplace, fantastic organization. They have said that their stats find that there are 3.6 times the accidents on the job and 5 times the accidents off the job. Well, when you're talking about insurance coverage, your insurance rate, when you're talking about, we have what is called the Bureau of Workers' Compensation here in Ohio, which is injured workers across the nation. HR responsibilities. There have been an awful lot of, there's been some company sued companies like Adecco in Maine and in Michigan, a trucking company, Dish Network actually in Colorado. They're being sued because they're using it. The people say they're using it for medical purposes, yet they're failing their drug test. So then they're fired. And marijuana is the number one reason for failed drug tests. So they're fired, so then they sue their employer. According to a Wall Street Journal article August of last year, the Wall Street Journal says it really is a problem for employers because a lawsuit from a medical marijuana claim can actually cost an employer about between $69,000 and $107,000 in court costs, and that doesn't even include any kind of award that is given. No one has won so far. However, the way that these laws are written, there will be a I'm sure a landmark case soon. We go back to regulate it and tax it. I'm sure that Colorado is going to see a huge influx of money this first month after legalizing in Colorado. But if you look at what it costs us compared to what we're getting, we're kind of getting society's getting the short end of the deal here. Alcohol taxes raise about $14.5 billion, but we're putting out $185 billion in lost productivity at work and for medical costs, especially to Medicaid and Medicare systems. The same goes for tobacco. Tobacco taxes raise about $25 billion, but you have $193 billion for tobacco societal costs. So really, you're not even getting close to what your investment is overall. According to the Rocky Mountain Hydro Report, you see that Colorado adult marijuana use has risen, really is much past the national average. National average is about 19%, and Colorado's is somewhere around 27%. In the 5 years, 2006 to 2011, there's actually been a 27% increase in marijuana use across the state. So I know I got to speed this up here. Really quick, going to the Colorado ER admissions, going back to this, that marijuana somehow is safer than peanuts and water. I've never seen anybody picked up for a driving under the influence of drugs for a peanut butter sandwich, so I don't know if that's true. This is what the Ohio Rights Group has actually used as their marketing campaign, a picture of Jesus with a big pot flower thing, says, "Relax, my dad made this." Kind of a safety is proclaimed from above. Nothing can be dangerous if it's made by God. But is marijuana safe? Has anyone died from an overdose? There is, not that I've ever known, not that I've ever seen, has anybody ever died from an overdose. However, no one has ever died from a cigarette overdose as well. However, what happens is you've got the long-term health effects, you've got the long-term issues with all kinds of different problems, and especially when you're adding in the psychosis and the schizophrenia pieces into the pot arguments, really can make for a life that does not quite reach potential. But those are some of the pieces that that are most common for people going into the ER, panic attacks, falls, and there's actually, I think it was diagnosed in 2004, something called cannabinoid hyperemesis syndrome, which is basically the amounts of THC in marijuana, which somewhere back in the day when it was in the 1970s, 1980s, about 4% THC, now it can reach up to about 30% in smoked marijuana. And then if you get into the dabbing and some of the other extracts, you can actually reach up to about 90% THC. And what has happened is that it causes extreme stomach pain, violent vomiting, that kind of stuff. According to the National Institute of Drug Abuse, 2009, marijuana was involved in about 376,000 ER visits. Again, higher rates for males. And out of all the illicit drugs, marijuana was the most common in 18 to 20-year-olds. There's a great comparison in the Rocky Mountain HIDA report, comparing 2006 to 2009 stats to 2010 to 2012, so the 3-year periods. What is troubling to me is that young people aged 0 to 5, there was a 200% increase in the number of ER visits. You're talking about 13 to 14-year-olds and 92%. Even in people who are not children, 26-plus, you're looking at a 69% increase in those two time periods. And, you know, you get the anecdotal stories. I think in Colorado there was a child 2 years old who died in a house fire who tested positive for THC. There was a gentleman that just a story came across my desk this morning of a gentleman that not in Colorado, in another one of the states, that had left his bathwater on for an 8-year-old or eight-month-old child. He went out, smoked pot, forgot about the kid. All of a sudden sees water pouring out from under the door. And his child has obviously drowned. So it's these types of things that are really, they're getting into their parents' pot, these types of things. Also go back to marijuana commercialization. These are some of the medicinal products that are out there right now. You're talking candy. You're talking medical cannabis, cotton candy. You got your chocolates, your beverages, and your lollipops. Also, kind of interesting, you got your Pop-Tarts, not your Pop-Tarts. You got your Nutella, which is now Nugtella, which is hazelnut spread with marijuana infused into it. And then also those look like regular candy bars, but that is not a Kit Kat in the middle in the upper left-hand corner. That's actually a Keef Kat. Milky Way is a Munchie Way. So there really is a lot of commercialization, including these types of things from Medbox, which is a marijuana-infused candies and drinks and all of this kind of stuff. So marijuana in 2011, as you can see, marijuana-related incidents accounted for 26% of the total ER visits, according to the Rocky Mountain HIDA report. And the Journal of the American Medical Association Pediatrics says that the consequences of unintentional marijuana exposure in children should be part of the ongoing debate on the legalization of marijuana. Finally, we're at the last section here, which is the diversion of Colorado marijuana. One of the 8 points that, again, Attorney General Eric Holder of the United States said is that we do not want, or he does not want this diverted to other states. This has to be highly regulated. However, in 2012, actually, Colorado pot was found to be going to 37 different states. And there's the top, I guess, eight states that it was destined for. So where is the regulation? 2005 to 2012, there was actually a 407% increase in interdiction seizures of marijuana. And not only is it just seizures of pot from state to state, but it's also the amount. 2005 to 2008, 2,220 pounds was the average number of pot seized, or the total amount of pot seized, whereas 2009 was 3,937. So as you see, the increases in pounds per year across really jumped in 2011 and 2012 with so much pot. But you think that, oh my gosh, we have a stereotype of what this is, a pot dealer, whatever. You got your hemp car, you got your guy with it in a trunk, and even the race car, cannabis-powered, I think it says. But really, the biggest diverter of marijuana is actually that little truck there that shows up to my house every day, the United States Postal Service. They try to do a good job of catching everything, but according to Brad Williams, at least 50% of everything that he gets is from one of those states where it's legal to grow, meaning Colorado or California. They seize at least one package coming in every day. So according to the United States Postal Service, again, you go 2011 to 2012 was a huge increase, and it's even surpassed that in the first 5 months of 2013 of last year. The number of intercepted packages from the Postal Service and also the pounds seized, so average pounds seized. I know I really went through this very, very quickly, and this again is about a six-hour piece that wanted to get out to everybody. Would like to promote this. I have nothing to do with HIDA. I know one guy in HIDA who's up in Cleveland, it's not my primary. It's not my organization. Mine is Drug Free Action Alliance, but I really think that those numbers kind of tell, where this experiment, as the president put it, as the HIDA report actually itself put it, is going, and perhaps can help you in any kind of decision making that you have to make in your own communities about whether marijuana is something that we really a road that we want to go down. The regulations to it, those types of things. These are fantastic resources. You can go to our page, which is drugfreeactionalliance.org /marijuana. There's CADCA, which is the Community Anti-Drug Coalitions of America. They have a tremendous amount of science, especially from the federal government, about marijuana, especially the brain research, those types of things. And then the SAM, which is the Smart Approaches to Marijuana, which is a bipartisan group headed up by Kevin Sabet, former Congressman Patrick Kennedy, who is the son of Ted Kennedy, and also David Frum, who is a speechwriter and a communication person in the Bush administration back in the mid-2000s. Their website is learnaboutsam.org. They've got a vast number of resources you can look at, you can kind of study. So at this point, I don't know what time it is, but we will take a couple of questions if you have them. Again, I thank you so much for joining me on this.
Thank you, everyone, for attending. There are several questions, and before we get into the questions section, I just wanted to let you know that the recording or the session has been recorded, and I will email the link to the recording along with the PowerPoint slides to you once it gets uploaded to our website. For the first question, there were several related to the driving under the influence of drugs. The first one was there was a 300% increase. Was that just linked to marijuana legalization, or can it be linked to an increase in marijuana testing? So is it a use issue, or is it just better testing issue?
It is just from the numbers that we got from the Colorado HIDA report, it is it could be because of testing. But from what I understand is that they do tests for marijuana, and this was before. Again, they kind of wanted to study this, especially the HIDA folks, from when marijuana first came legal into the state of Colorado. So again, these are numbers that are coming from the Rocky Mountain HIDA report, and hopefully they're not just because of testing. They are because of actually we want them down to nothing. So I hope that answers your question.
You. And the next question, oh, I'm sorry, that was from Paul. The next questions are from Catherine and Ruth. They asked the same question. Were traffic fatalities linked exclusively to marijuana, or did it also include other drugs, the increase in traffic fatalities?
There were other drugs in some of those. In the Rocky Mountain HIDA report, they have listed those, and I don't know if that's actually said. I found that through a roundabout way. However, It was not the number. It was not the amount of people, and especially marijuana. When you mix marijuana and alcohol, those really become somewhat of a deadly combination. There's a great. It's very sad, but there's an interesting documentary done on that, and it's called What Happened to Ant? It was on HBO, and I have to think of what the ant's name was. But There's Something Wrong with Aunt Diane. That's what it is. There's Something Wrong with Aunt Diane, an HBO documentary that was done about the dangers that go on when you mix alcohol and marijuana. There were other drugs that were in some of those drivers had other drugs in their system.
Thank you. The next question is from James. And James' question is, the president's comments seem to support marijuana use. Do you have recommendations for what we can say to our communities and our children?
I think what we have to say, and they seem to be geared toward legalizing, but you know, he even said about, you know, I would not want my own children to do this. And I think that's what you say to your children, is that the president really came out and said that he wishes that young people, this is not something to get involved in. This is not something that he wants people to get with. I think if I were, and when I talk to my kids, if you noticed, and he has every opportunity to do that. I mean, he can work with Congress if he wanted to make this a legal substance, and yet has not. So his thoughts are, I guess, is that he makes this a legal substance, see how it works, see how it runs in these two states, and then decides. But he has not made the decision, even though he could push this as a national agenda, to make it a legal product. And he actually said that as well in a statement on January 31st, which was to clarify what he had meant in the New Yorker article that previous weekend.
Thank you. Our next question is related to the marijuana-infused edibles. And are the marijuana-infused products only available in Colorado? That question comes from Christine.
Yes. However, what is interesting is, and this just happened a week ago, I got pictures from one of our folks that we work with here in Ohio, and they had picked up like 120 pounds of pot and then a vast amount of edibles. So it is reaching all across the nation, but they're only legal in Colorado, and I'm guessing they'll be legal in Washington. Washington is not quite legal yet. They're still, from what I understand, somewhere between March and May are going to be when it's fully open for recreational purposes. But right now, the edibles are legal in Colorado, from what I understand.
And Sally just had a comment related to the New Yorker article, and her comment was, if you read the whole New Yorker piece, he does not say he supports legalization. Our next question is from Jessica, and her question is, where can we find the Tony Lynn quote?
The Tony Lynn quote is actually in, it's in the Daily Northwestern. It's the actual Northwestern newspaper. It is from, the article was written by a girl named Rebecca Savransky, and that's Savransky. And I can actually send everybody, when Derek sends out the link, I can include this in the email packet that Derek sends you. I'd be more than happy to do that. But it was found in the Daily Northwestern from January 7th. And again, the author's name was Rebecca Savransky, who's a Northwestern student. So we will certainly send that to you as well.
And the question from Nancy is, what can we do to retract marijuana legalization?
Well, I mean, quite frankly, and this is what I talk about a lot in a lot of the presentations I do, is that I think it's this type of information, these hard numbers, not going after those reefer madness things, or I saw something the other day that talked about marijuana is going to turn us into a zombie nation and have the Walking Dead on there. I think if you use those, it just makes you look like a fool. It is like these numbers, and there is more and more and more information that is coming out about the dangers, especially young people, the developing brain, what it's doing to business. I send out every 2 weeks what's called the Blunt Truth newsletter, which is just basically four or five news stories filled with new studies that have been found, impacts on business, impacts on public safety, and those types of things. I'd be more than happy to add you to the list. It's a free thing. It doesn't cost you anything. Just want to get more of the word out. So there really is, and I think putting those numbers in front of legislators, putting those numbers in front of community leaders, it is amazing how many communities have had what I call buyer's remorse, that this was not, it's presented that marijuana, especially when they do it as medicine, is going to be, is kind of this for, people with end-of-life issues, when really the person who is the average marijuana cardholder across the nation is a 32-year-old white male with no history of chronic illness, but the person has a history of drug abuse. So, presenting those types of things, and again, I go more with the policy issue. Read the language of what is actually in there. When you talk about the ability, like in Ohio, the ability to test for impairment for employers, for law enforcement, that says a lot more than even brain development issues for young people. So look at your language. Let people know, wait a second, this is how this affects me. And that's, I do a big long thing on that. So it's kind of hard to answer in a couple minutes, but those really, really put the message to what the person, the organization really, really cares about. I would never go into a business and start talking youth brain development. They care. I'm not saying they don't. However, the bottom line is what they really care about, and how that is going to affect profit, how that's going to affect the safety of my workforce, how that's going to affect my BW, my workers' comp rates and my health insurance rates and all of those types of things. So those are what we do. And actually, I think we can actually turn the tide on this. And I'm not being overly pessimistic or overly optimistic. I really do think, but too much longer, and you can't put the toothpaste back in the tube.
Thank you, Tony. We do have several more questions, but I know that we're coming to the end of our hour. We will continue beyond, but also want to let you know that we do want to see, get your feedback and know how we can continually improve on the programs offering that we have. So after this session, I will send out a survey just for you to give us your feedback so we can continue to make improvements and also to get feedback as to what other topics you'd like. Sarah Henry with Drug Free Action Alliance will be the presenter for our next webinar featuring the We Are the Majority program. She will also talk about the Ohio Youth-Led Prevention Network and the efforts underway in Ohio to take youth-led prevention and have it as a united front. Talk about some of the evaluation efforts that are underway there. So that will be on March 11th, 2014. And again, if you have questions for Tony, his contact information is here. We'll get back to the questions. If you have questions, please feel free to ask them in the questions section of your go-to webinar navigation panel. And our next question is related to the information on the arrests for marijuana. Mm-hmm. The question is from Sally, and her question is, where did you get the statistics from the arrests?
The arrests are from the actual imprisonments. because those are different things. The arrests I actually got from the Marijuana Policy Project, about 700,000 arrests. The Bureau of Justice actually is where I got the statistics from the for the federal imprisonments, and then also the National Council on State Legislatures. Actually is where I got kind of more of the state inmates information. So there's different different systems of imprisonment. So those are where I got those.
Thank you. And on a related note, this question is from Brenna. And Brenna's question is, do you have a list of all your references you used in studies you cited in the PowerPoint?
Yeah, absolutely. I'd be more than happy to do that. We will absolutely send that in the email that Derek sends. Absolutely, and we are absolutely nowhere without our science. I actually did a debate, and I was actually the pro pot person. It was kind of freeing because I didn't have to quote any kind of citations. I actually made up a story and got applauded by someone, but made it up and. Why they believed it was because it was the craziest story I've ever told. However, absolutely, without our citations, we're nothing.
And these questions are from Sonia and Lori, and they're both related to your Blunt Truth newsletter. And their question is, how can they sign up for it?
You can just send me an email, and we will absolutely get you signed up. My contact information is right there. Again, it's free, and it's not no solicitation. I'm not going to add anything and all that. So I would love for the more people to get this as possible and just kind of get what really is going on across the nation so that you have stories that you can also share within your own community.
And question from Jessica, and you made reference to this being part of your six-hour presentation, and can we link into the six-hour presentation somewhere?
I know that Allison handles all of our trainings, quite frankly. I don't do, I am the policy guy. I don't do any math, and I don't do any sales type of stuff. So if you want to contact Allison Scherer, who Derek is actually making a slide for right now. Contact her and she can get you hooked up with everything. It's exciting to do these types of things because it really does open people's eyes and gets them to thinking, maybe this isn't the best thing. And I never ever will argue a moral standpoint. I can't change people's morals. All I can do is take a look at real numbers and real science and real policy. How does this affect everybody in a community? So there's Allison's information, and she signs up trainings and all that kind of stuff. So contact her and she'll be able to help you.
This question is from Lynette, and in Wyoming, we're having a huge issue with young people believing that they can safely inhale marijuana through e-cigarettes. Mm-hmm. What are your recommendations for us?
I think what is interesting, there is more. I would go to CADCA, that CADCA.org site that I had listed. They have a tremendous amount of resources on that, a great organization that again, is based in science. Also, the learnaboutsam.org, they have some resources as well about e-cigarettes and about some of the vaporizing techniques that are being used. From what I understand, the e-cigarettes, kids can actually smoke them in school. There's no odor. Vapor is vapor. It disappears. It's not smoke. So kids are picking up on this and starting to do this, to smoke marijuana through these types of contraptions.
And then there is one comment and one question related to edibles. From Kathy in California, she says, just a comment, although the edibles may be illegal, they are being sold in dispensaries here in California. And the second question, or comment, I guess, as well, is from Tamara, and she said, I just found 560,000 sites online that will sell edible marijuana products. So Just because it may be limited legally doesn't mean that there won't be opportunities to access it illegally like we're seeing in other states.
And that has happened in Ohio. Thank you so much. Because that is just because it's legal in California doesn't mean it, again, kind of like the interdictions that we talked about. In fact, what's interesting, too, is Nebraska is actually talking about starting to charge Colorado. They want to start billing Colorado. I mean, it'd have to go through a legislative process. For all of the police, time that is being taken with marijuana coming across their state lines. I just thought that was interesting. They did that. They were talking about that back in October, November. And if you want that, I can send you that story as well. The email that Derek will send you.
This question is from Teresa. Can we use your slides and information on our own websites?
Absolutely. I encourage you, we've all got to be in this together. So the more that you can get this information out, absolutely. The HIDTA report is on our website under resources. Feel free to use that. It's probably a 50-some page booklet. Use the website or use the slides in your own trainings and those types of things so that you can share the information. Again, these are stats along with, it's 56 pages. So there are an awful lot of anecdotal stories, especially about interdictions, how it's going into other states, and some of the police reports that have been kind of capsulized.
Okay, we just have two questions remaining so far. If you have additional questions, you can ask it in the question section of your GoToWebinar navigation panel. This information was great, but what do you think is the best way to get the information out to people who just don't want to hear it?
That's from Tiffany. Here's what I think, and this is what this is the way I see things. There are, if you look at what we call high involvement versus low involvement audiences. High involvement audiences are people who already have a strong opinion, one way or the other, on the issue. So right now, I'm guessing there's about 20% of people who are really, really rabid about marijuana legalization and are for it. There's probably 10%, maybe there are 20% of people, but we've been bullied into silence. Who are against marijuana legalization. So what you have is between 60 and 70% of people who are just like, why do I care? It's not even it's not a strong opinion. I concentrate on those people. And it's interesting how you can change minds. I will not do a program with I was invited to a radio program yesterday or somebody invited me to. And I won't do that. I'm not going to stand there and get beat up and all of that. But there are minds that can be changed. And if you can apply it to their workplace, if you can apply it to, you know what, your kid is starting to drive or your kid is getting on a school bus and we can't test for a bus driver to be under the influence of marijuana. Those are things that hit people directly and make it not so much about a moral obligation to get people out of pain. However, it does hit you that I don't want to put my kid on a school bus where the person can't be tested for marijuana because it has been taken out through any kind of legislation or constitutional amendment in my state.
Thank you. This question is from Gail. Considering 10% of the population have an addictive personality, is marijuana a better alternative to other addictive substances such as ETOH or cigarettes?
What is the question?
Is marijuana a better alternative to other drugs?
Quite frankly, I don't know. And this is what I'm asked an awful lot. And with the science starting to come out, this is science that is all new. There were not too many studies done about marijuana and its impact both long-term and short-term. Again, you've got some of those older studies that, oh, it's gonna, the devil's gonna get you, and all of those marketing campaigns. But real science, does it kill you? No. No one's ever died from an overdose. Can it cause long-term effects? Can it disrupt a person who is trying to make it through each day, trying to make it a family? Does it destroy families? Absolutely. So is it better? I think it's quite frankly worse than cigarettes, especially. They found the British Lung Institute just released something this past week that they said that 3 joints a day are equal to 20 cigarettes. So because of the and the lung cancer implications. So and I could send that report as well. So I don't. I like what Kevin Sabet has to say. You know, we get asked an awful lot. Well, isn't it? I mean, alcohol is already legal. So what's the big deal? Well, he says that just because your tail or your headlight is broken, does not mean that you go back and break the tail light. You know, you have to. You know, let's learn from what we have and from the probably the greatest scientific era that we've ever had in the history of mankind. So I hope that answers your question. I don't think it's better than anything, in fact, quite a bit worse than some things.
Thank you. This question is from Sue. Can you please repeat where you can find a copy of the Rocky Mountain HIDA report? Is it on the Drug Free Action Alliance website? And I will just take that one since it's up on my screen now. Yes, it is available at drugfreeactionalliance.org/marijuana. We have marijuana resources. We've got ballot initiatives. We've got other issues that you can see in addition to the marijuana quiz. Tony, do you want to talk a little bit about the marijuana quiz?
Yeah, the marijuana quiz is just a basic kind of quiz that it's 10 questions. It's kind of fun to share with individuals who, especially young people, who kind of get so many mixed messages about marijuana. You can look at that. It's it has all of the answers, some talking points along with it. Something that is fun to share with individuals, help them test their knowledge. It's actually a good way to also start, like, you know, coalition meetings or even, I wouldn't take it to a business. The last thing they want to do is take a quiz. But, you know, gauge some other members who are, who might have some stake in the game, in your coalition and your community organization, and just see what the answers are, and it starts a pretty good conversation. Derek, do you want to press on resources? I'll show them exactly where the HIDA report is.
And while you're pulling that up, there was a question about where are the answers to the quiz. That question is from Heidi.
They are right on the they're right on the quiz. So if you go
Okay. Oh, do I need to go back?
Yeah. Let's do this. The marijuana resources. I'll show you how to get the HIDA report first. This is where the fun begins. So if you go to get the HIDA report, you go down and you scroll down in the marijuana resources section. We need to fix that big white space. And right under resources, at the very bottom, it says Rocky Mountain HIDA right there. That's the entire report for you. I guess it's 66. I said 56. So that's the report. And again, you're more than welcome. It's a publicly paid for document, so you can take it and do whatever you want with it. The quiz is right there, and the answers are right on the quiz sheet.
Continuing with our questions, how do you present the information in light of the compassionate care argument, i.e., we are not being compassionate towards those who need marijuana, from Maryland?
Actually, I'm approached with this an awful lot, usually with people who have children with what's called Dravet syndrome. There are a couple ways that I answer it. First off, that I am, I not only want I absolutely understand. I have had loved ones myself who have went through tremendous amounts of pain because of cancer, because of other diseases. I've watched friends pass away from Lou Gehrig's disease and those types of HIV. I've seen that. And I really don't have a problem. If you have an end-of-life issue, if you're in hospice, quite frankly, I'm not really worried. And let's be honest, nobody's busting down the door of a person in hospice who's smoking a joint. It's the people who are not using it for medicinal reasons. And also, if you don't have end-of-life issues, if it is for chronic pain, I want to make sure that you're okay long term, that the long term consequences aren't going to affect the way that you react to things, or the way that or your ability to get a job, or your ability to function. Somebody just literally came to me about an hour and a half ago. I've been on here for an hour. Within an hour and a half ago, right before I came on, that said, that in California they started a marijuana anonymous website. Marijuana Anonymous group, much like the Alcoholics Anonymous, and do we have that here in Ohio? And, you know, I had to say no. But that's how I always handle it. With the Dravet syndrome, which is you see a lot of these little children with epilepsy and these seizures and such, there's actually a program called the Orphan Drug Law that it's called they would be eligible, they would be able to apply for something for a CBD-based medication, which is a component in marijuana. It's called Epidolix. And what happens is, this is federal, this is kind of an experimental drug. The Orphan Drug Law was created back in the 1980s for HIV patients, for all of the experimental drugs that were going on during that health crisis. This is the same type of system where people can actually apply to have their children get this. Now, smart approaches to marijuana and I talk about is, and this is how I answer those types of things, is I would be more than happy to walk with you to or sign a letter or whatever for this child to get. To become part of that orphan drug law program. Nobody wants to see suffering. But I also don't want to see what is going to happen to that child 10 years down the road when we use an untested medicine, which includes THC, which is a raw plant, all of those types of things. We do not use willow tree bark for aspirin. We've actually taken a component out of there, made it into an aspirin because it's safe, it's effective, we know the dosage, all of those types of things. I have the same compassion for those children. And I would walk hand in hand to not only work with them on expanding that orphan drug law program, but also in applying. So that's how I answer those types of things.
Thank you. The next question is from Teresa, and her question is, I live in New York, and the pro-marijuana supporters have changed their approach to compassion issues. Sorry, I just talked about that. Thank you. I didn't delete my slides or questions as I was going through. Please accept my apologies. The next statement is from Sue, related to Marijuana Anonymous, and she said you can go to marijuanaanonymous.org for additional resources, which includes a list of where meetings are held. So again, that website is www.marijuana-anonymous.org, so make sure you put the hyphen in there when you're researching that.
Thank you so much, Sue.
And this question is from Mallory Moon. Melissa Sargent was motivated in part by the fact that Wisconsin has the fifth highest racial disparity between blacks and whites when it comes to marijuana-related arrests. Decriminalizing marijuana, she said, would save time and money for law enforcement, and taxing it would raise revenue for the state. How do we deal with legislators that think this way?
Well, first off, I think we do need to have an honest conversation about the disparity in arrests between African Americans and Caucasians, especially surrounding marijuana. I think you absolutely concede that, and we will work with anybody on that. But let's get real about the information that most people are not going to prison for pot. Plus, I mean, the great examples are, again, going back to tobacco and alcohol. You can see that they're bringing in, you know, $14 billion and I think $25 billion, $14 billion for alcohol and $25 billion for cigarettes. But as you look, I mean, all legislators also are looking mainly at their Medicaid numbers. They're looking at how many people are on our rolls. How can our state sustain the growth in Medicaid? Another hot topic is, you know, how the health care system and the Affordable Care Act. Prevention, if you can prevent people from getting into those situations, then you can actually save the state money. And if we could prevent getting into marijuana legalization and all of those other issues that are going to happen because of it, using the Rocky Mountain Hydra report, the savings to your state will be huge. Another thing I really want to address is these cartels somehow going to cut down on the cartels, and it absolutely is not. There have been some articles that I've read that basically what cartels are doing is they're just diversifying. Plus, if most of this marijuana is grown in the United States, Mexican cartels aren't affected. According to most pot smokers that I've talked to, they don't even like Mexican pot because it's ditch weed, is what they call it. So it's mostly homegrown. It's not affecting the cartels. And if it is at all, it's actually causing them to go into more violent crimes like human trafficking, which is far worse than any and a far bigger moneymaker than any kind of marijuana trafficking.
Thank you. And the next question is for Ginger. Her question is, what is being done about doctors who hand out marijuana cards to people who really should not be having them? Is there a smart approach to monitoring how and when doctors hand out cards?
I mean, that's got to be done legislatively. We just, in Ohio, in the last 2 years, we took a lot of unscrupulous doctors surrounding the prescription pill era. Now, there are doctors galore who are, I shouldn't say galore, there's probably a couple percentage points of doctors who are administering or giving out the majority of medical marijuana cards. I know in Arizona, 46% of all the marijuana cards that are given in the state are given by 9 doctors. There's a gentleman in California who also is big into this, who just basically has moved to Catalina Island and set up iPads around his room. Basically, you call into this, you FaceTime into this iPad, and he will write you a prescription for a medical marijuana card. And you, but there has to be legislation, and there's got to be working. You know, if this is really going to be regulated, like they say it is, you have to take the ability away for these types of things happening. And it's, again, it's been done, I know in Ohio and many other states, to take the prescription pill problem, to get rid of these doctors who are prescribing these things, and the same type of situation has to be done on a state scale as well.
And our final question of the day is, what recommendations for creative ideas and venues for how preventionists are reaching mass populations on a limited budget do you have for us?
It's interesting. The majority of my talks anymore are to safety councils, which are business organizations. They have to have, in Ohio, these safety councils, which you get a discount on your rate for a workers' comp rate, they have to attend one of these a month. So that is where the majority of people that I talk to anymore are actually located. It doesn't cost me anything. Also, chambers of commerce around your state are another group that are interested in this, and they invite me from time to time. But you have to kind of reach out of the traditional prevention partners and actually go outside and make, you know, make those partnerships. If you have a coalition, you've got a lot of those folks on your board already. And usually what happens is when I go out to a business organization and they see me present, then what happens is there's two or three people that come up to me afterwards and say, hey, I really need to know about this. Can you come talk to my organization? And it is just that partnership. Prevention, you're never going to get rich. But if you have partners like business folk and who can talk to community leaders and those types of things, it really goes a lot farther than me standing up in front of a prevention group and talking to the choir.
Thank you. And then the last comment that we have, and then we will close out for today, is Tony, can you clarify the difference between a marijuana recommendation and a prescription that's run through the FDA?
Yeah. Marijuana prescription, there is no such thing in the United States. It is a Schedule I drug. It can't be prescribed by any physician. A pharmacy cannot dispense it. They're all either recommendations or, as more marijuana laws or medicinal marijuana laws are passed across the country, a lot of times now they're just a diagnosis. So a recommendation, there are absolutely no physicians writing prescriptions. It's either all recommendation or just a diagnosis, which means that basically all you have to have is the problem on the list of covered illnesses, and you can get your card or whatever for $100.
Thank you, and that's all the questions and time that we have for today. Just to recap, the resources that I will be sending out will be the link to the recorded session, the PowerPoint presentation, the marijuana resources that were both in his presentation, as well as a link to drugfreeactionalliance.org/marijuana, and a notice to sign up for the Blunt Truth newsletter. Thank you so much for your time to invest in this hour and a half to hopefully learn and think about other things that you can do to positively impact your community. If you have any questions or need additional assistance, you can contact Tony at 614-540-9985 or tcoder at drugfreeactionalliance.org. Thank you again so much for your time, and we hope you'll join us at our next webinar on March 11th for the We Are the Majority message. Thank you so much, and have a great day.